Hello guys, welcome to another video. Today we're going to work at topic 12 for AHL. We're going to work on a couple of multiple choice questions, so let's jump straight to the paper and see the solutions. Number one, it says that a mean electron of low energy is enclosed within a high potential barrier. What is the process by which the electron can escape? So here we talk about quantum tunneling, of course. It's nothing else from the other ones. The phenomenon where a wave function or a particle can propagate through a potential barrier is the quantum tunneling. So this is your correct answer, A. Number two, a beam of monochromatic radiation is made up of photons, each of momentum p. The density of the beam is doubled without changing frequency. What is the momentum of each photon after the change? So what do we have here, based on the Broglie's wavelength, we have this relationship with wavelength and momentum. So actually momentum, if you solve for momentum, is Planck's constant divided by the wavelength. But here we know that the frequency is constant. If frequency is constant, then wavelength is constant. If wavelength is constant, then the momentum is unchanged as well. So correct answer here is B. Number three, three observations of the behavior of electrons are electron emission as a result of the photoelectric effect, electron diffraction as an electron interacts with an atom, emission of radio waves as a result of electrons oscillating in a conductor. Which observations are evidence that the electron behaves as a particle? Of course, out of these options, here only number two, it shows that the electrons, they behave as waves. So number one and number two, they show that they behave as particles. So correct answer here, it's B, one and three only. Number seven, a metallic surface is first irradiated with infrared radiation and photoelectrons are emitted from the surface. The infrared radiation is replaced by ultraviolet radiation of the same intensity. What will be the change in the kinetic energy of the photoelectrons and the rate at which they are ejected? Let's see first the kinetic energy here. So what we do here, we change the radiation from infrared, we change it to ultraviolet. Ultraviolet, it has smaller wavelength. So that means that it has bigger frequency. So bigger frequency, it means bigger energy. So kinetic energy will increase, either A, either C. Now let's see what is happening with the rate of ejected photoelectrons. The density here is kept constant, but we have more energetic photons. So it means that we have less photons. In order to keep the density constant, when you have more energetic photons, you need to throw less photons. So as you decrease the number of photons, the rate also, it needs to decrease. So it's either A, either B. Correct answer here, of course, it's A. Number eight, the half-life of a radioactive nuclide is 8 seconds. The initial activity of a pure sample of the nuclide is 10,000 becquerels. What is the approximate activity of the sample after 4 seconds? So what we have here, initially, we have 10,000 becquerels, and then after a passing of 8 seconds, as it is the half-life, you're going to have half of them. You're going to have 5,000 becquerels. So of course, cannot be B or A. Now we want to see what is happening here at 4 seconds, so at this part for 4 seconds. So of course, it cannot be the half of this part because the relationship of the activity is exponential. It's not linear, so it cannot be D. So it is C. Number nine. A particle is confined within a nucleus. What is the order of magnitude of the uncertainty in the momentum of the particle? So what we try to find here is the uncertainty of the momentum. So we're going to use the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It comes from this formula. And now you know that the uncertainty in X, because the particle is confined within a nucleus, it's going to be 10 to the power of negative 15. Because this is the diameter of a nucleus. So what I need to do here is I need to solve this equation, 10 to the power of negative 15 times delta P, bigger or equal, whatever, it doesn't really matter for us here. I'm going to take it equal As h Planck's constant, it has the order of magnitude of 10 to the power of negative 34. So if I solve here for delta p, 10 to the power of negative 34 divided by 10 to the power of negative 15, 34 here. Okay, so if you do the math, you're going to have 10 to the power of negative 19, so it's approximately 10 to the power of negative 20. So the answer here is C. Number 10, a proton has momentum of 10 to the power of negative 20 newtons times seconds. And the uncertainty of the position of the proton is 10 to the power of negative 10 meters. What is the minimum fractional uncertainty in the momentum of this proton? First of all, we need to find the absolute uncertainty of the momentum and then the fractional. In order to find the absolute uncertainty, again, we need to use the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. For minimum, this bigger or equal, it can be just equal, that is h over 4 pi. So now I'm going to solve here for delta p. So you have h over 4 pi delta x. And I'm going to substitute the numbers here. Planck's constant, 6.63 times 10 to the power of negative 34. 4 times pi, 3.14. Times delta x, it's 10 times to the power of negative 10. And now I'm going to do the math here. 4 times 3 is 12, so I have 6 over 12. This goes up times 10 to the power of negative 24. So 6 over 12, it's 0.5 times 10 to the power of negative 24. So it is just 5 times 10 to the power of negative 25. And this is the uncertainty, the absolute uncertainty on momentum. For the fractional uncertainty, I have to take the absolute divided by the value. So it's 5 times 10 to the power of negative 25 divided by the momentum. It has a value of 10 to the power of negative 20. So it's 5 times 10 to the power of negative 5. So correct answer here is C. Number 11. Photons of a certain frequency incident on a metal surface cause the emission of electrons from the surface. The intensity of the light is constant and the frequency of photons is increased. What is the effect, if any, on the number of emitted electrons and the energy of emitted electrons? So this is exactly as the same before. We have increasing frequency, so it means energy is increased. So either B, either D. We have constant intensity, so less photons, less more energetic photons. So of course, we have a decrease in the number of emitted electrons. So 11 is B. And number 12, three possible features of an atomic model are orbital radius, quantized energy, quantized angular momentum. Which of these are features of the Bohr model for hydrogen? And of course, here they are all of them. So it's 1, 2, and 3. All of them we explain in the Bohr's model for the hydrogen atom. Number 13. Photons of discrete energy are emitted during gamma decay. This is evidence for atomic energy level, nuclear energy levels, pre-annihilation, or quantum tunneling. So what you have here you have a nucleus that is a little bit unstable after a decay or something. So it needs to emit a photon. It needs to emit a discrete energy photon in order to be more stable. So this is evidence, of course, of nuclear energy levels. Number 16. Which is the correct Feynman diagram for per-annihilation and per-production? Per-annihilation and per-production, it means that we have a particle and an antiparticle and they interact each other and they form energy, or energy is forming a particle and an antiparticle. So what we need to see here in the Feynman diagram, you need to check the arrows actually and see where do you have particles and antiparticles. The particles, the arrows, they're opposite to the time. So here you have two particles. It cannot be A. Here you have two particles, it cannot be C. Here you have a particle and an antiparticle. Here you have a particle and an antiparticle. But after, here you see that you have two particles. And then you have, so it cannot be B. So in D you have particle, antiparticle, particle antiparticle as well. So it's number D. And number 17, it says that the graph shows the variation of the natural log of activity in LN activity, the natural log, against time for a radioactive nuclide. What is the decay constant in days to the power of negative 1 of the radioactive nuclide? So what we need to do here is to work with the activity formula that it says the activity is equal with the initial activity times e to the power of negative lambda t. So from here, I need to solve this formula for lambda. So what I have to do is I have to take the natural log in both sides. I need to play a little bit with math here. So from here, this relationship, it becomes lna is equal with ln a0 minus ln e minus lambda t. So from here, what you have is lna equals to ln a0 minus lambda times t. So I need to isolate lambda here, so I moved from the other side, I moved ln a to the other side, so lambda times t equals to ln a 0 minus ln a. And I divide, of course, by t, so I have ln a 0 minus ln a divided by time. Now you can take whichever points you want. Of course, you're going to take the initial point for a 0, and this is 6 minus, you can choose whatever you like, very obvious point, it's here. So you have 0 for the activity divided by the 1 days. So this, of course, it will give you the number 6. So that was all for today. A little bit difficult topic, but again, it's HL, so no complaints. So study hard and good luck.